Let's jump into the topic, make or buy with a limiting factor. Let's analyze the problem in depth. This lady is in the business of making cakes, and she also wants to make the two raw materials that are required for the cake. What are the two raw materials? Butter and icing sugar. But the problem is she cannot make both the raw materials. Why? Because she has got limited labor hours. Now, the question that she's asking is, should she buy the butter or should she buy the icing sugar from outside? Because she's unable to make both the raw materials because of limited labor hours. Now, whenever there is a situation of make or buy with the limiting factor, there are two underlying assumptions. The first one is making is cheaper. And the second one is resources are limited to produce all the raw materials. So we would definitely like to make all the raw materials because that is cheaper. But unfortunately, our resources are limited. In this particular problem, what is a limited resource? It is direct labor hours. So how do we tackle such kind of problems? There are mainly two steps which are involved. First of all, we have to calculate savings. We know that making is cheaper. So definitely, the variable cost of making will be lesser than the buying cost. And the second step is calculate savings per limiting factor. So limiting factor can either be the quantity of raw materials, that is in kg, or it could be the machine hours or the labor hours. In this particular case, it is labor hours which is limited. So what should we calculate? We should calculate the savings per labor hour. And why are we calculating this? Because labor hours is limited, it is valuable. So each minute, if you can save more, that's better, right? Now let's get to the details of the problem. So these are the facts of the case. The demand for cakes is 3,000 cakes per month, and the raw materials that are required for cake, that is butter, one unit is 200 grams of butter. The demand is 3,000 units of butter, and as far as icing sugar, one unit which is equal to 400 grams packet, the demand for icing sugar is 3,000 units. The variable cost per unit of butter is $1 per unit, and icing sugar is again $1. Buying cost is $1.5 for the butter and $1.5 for the icing sugar. Both the variable cost and the buying cost as far as the butter and the icing sugar is concerned are same, which means that the savings per unit as far as butter is concerned is $1.5 minus $1 or $0.5 per unit. And as far as icing sugar is concerned, it is also 1.5 minus $1, which is $0.5 per unit. Now is the turning point. Labor hours per unit is 0.2 hours for the butter and only 0.1 hour for the icing sugar. It takes lesser time for making icing sugar than the butter. Since the labor hours is limited and valuable, it will be definitely better to make icing sugar. In order to confirm our belief, we will go by what they have said. What should we calculate next? Savings per hour. So savings per hour of butter, it is 0.5 divided by 0.2 hours, or it is $2.5 per hour. And as far as icing sugar is concerned, it is 0.5 divided by 0.1 hours or $5 per hour. See the difference? Because icing sugar takes lesser time, the savings per hour is more for the icing sugar, $5 per hour, while the savings per hour for butter is just $2.5 per hour, which means that we should make icing sugar first. So the ranking will be, the first rank will be for icing sugar. That is, we should make icing sugar first. And if we have got balance time, we will definitely make butter. So the second ranking is for butter. So we will start the production of icing sugar. We know that the demand for icing sugar is 3,000 units. So maximum we need to produce only 3,000 units. So I've written 3,000 units of icing sugar to be produced. Now we know that the labor hours is limited to 360 hours per month. So we will make a note of that too. Hours taken total is 360 hours because that is what is given in the question. Now, for making 3,000 units of icing sugar, how much time is being taken? For one unit, it is 0.1 hours. So for 3000 units, it is 3000 into 0.1 or 300 hours. So once we complete the production of icing sugar, 300 hours is gone, which means that out of 360, we will reduce 300 hours. Now the balance hours is only 60 hours. Now we will make butter. Now for making that total quantity of butter, which is required, that's the demand for 3000 units of butter. How much time is required? For one unit, it is 0.2 hours. So for 3000 units, it is 3000 into 0.2 hours or 600 hours is required. But do we have 600 hours? No, we have just 60 hours left. So in the 60 hours, how much butter we can make? This is what we have to answer. So against the hour taken, we will write the balance available hours. Only 60 hours is available for us. In the 60 hours, how much butter can we make? For one unit, 0.2 hours. So in 60 hours, how much can we produce? It is 60 divided by 0.2 or 300 units of butter only we can produce. So out of the 3000 units, we can make just 300 units. So the balance, that is 3000 units minus 300 units, 2700 units, you are forced to buy from outside. So the final decision is make 300 units of butter and buy 2700 units of butter and make the entire quantity of 3000 units of icing sugar in-house. Now, a popular doubt that arises for many students is the difference between make or buy with the limiting factor and make or buy with no limiting factors. The video on make or buy with no limiting factors have already been uploaded, the link of which is given above. Do watch that video first for a better understanding. Now, in a make or buy with no limiting factors, we are comparing the making cost with the buying cost. And the making cost comprises of the variable cost, the specific fixed cost, and the lost cash inflow. But if it is a make or buy with limiting factors, here again, we are comparing the making cost with the buying cost, but in this making cost, it is only the variable cost which is included. Now, this is what is creating confusion among the students. In make or buy with no limiting factors, the making cost comprises of three elements, but in the make or buy with limiting factors, the making cost comprises of only one element, that is the variable cost. Now, the principal difference between the two is in a make or buy with no limiting factors, we do not know whether the making cost or the buying cost is lower. That is, we do not know whether making is cheaper. We are trying to find it out. So for that reason, we will take all the additional expenses that we will be incurring if we decide to make. So what is the first additional expense? Definitely, we will incur the variable cost of making the particular component. And the next item is the specific fixed cost, like if you are taking a machinery on rental for making this component, then definitely that should also be included under making cost because that's an additional expense. And the third item is the lost cash inflow. As an example, we could say the lost rental income of the factory space. Now, currently we might be receiving a rental income for the factory space, but if we decide to make the component, then we cannot let it out, which means that we will be losing that rental income, lost cash inflow. So lost cash inflow is always relevant and hence it will figure under making cost. But if we are taking the second scenario, that is make or buy with limiting factors, then the primary assumption is making is cheaper. That is, we have already found out by comparing the making cost and the buying cost that making is cheaper than buying. It is only because of the limiting factor that we are unable to make the entire quantity of the component which is demanded. Now let's take the first item which is causing the difference. Specific fixed cost. Example, rent of machinery that we are using for the product. Now, even if we have the opportunity to make one unit of the component, we will definitely make it because making is cheaper, which means that we will still be using that machinery on rental. We may not be returning the machinery for the simple reason that we are waiting for an opportunity to make the product. So as soon as we get the limiting factor, say if it's a direct labor or the machine hours, we will immediately start making. Whether we are making or whether we are buying, we will still incur that specific fixed cost. It's not incremental between the options. It's not different between the options. And hence, we do not include the rental of the machinery in a make or buy with limiting factor. Due to the same logic, we will not be including the lost rental income of the factory space also. Now, here again, we are waiting for an opportunity to make the product. Just because we are having a limiting factor, that is labor hours or machine hours, we will not immediately let out that factory space. We'll wait for the opportunity to make because making is cheaper. That is the reason why we are including only the variable cost, because the other two items, that is the specific fixed cost and the lost cash inflow, will remain unchanged. And hence, in the make or buy with limiting factor, these two items will be excluded for the simple reason that it is not different between the options. So the primary difference is because in the first scenario, we are trying to find out whether making or buying is cheaper. But in the second scenario, we already know that making is cheaper. So here we come to an end of yet another topic of the ACCA F5 Performance Management paper. If you have benefited from the video, I request you to support the channel by clicking the subscribe and the like button. So thank you for watching and see you in the next video.